next African story will be written by Africans. Meet the people using technology, innovation, and entrepreneurship to craft this new narrative. This is Building the Future Podcast with your host, Dotun, coming up today on Building the Future.
I went home, and at the time I was in a relationship, and I said to my partner, he goes, oh, why are you home early? I said, I kind of left my job, and he looked at me like I was the craziest person on the planet. This is recession. People don't leave jobs. What on earth are you doing? He said to me, so what are you going to do? And I said, do you know what? I want to try and do something of my own. He said, what? I said, I don't know yet. I'll figure it out.
That's really scary.
I remember that period of my life just sitting there, staring at the TV, just looking and thinking like, just hit me with the idea already. Give me something. Give me something.
You're looking for ideas.
You know when you're just staring into like nothing and you just wait for something to hit you.
This series is in partnership with the British Council in Nigeria. The British Council is the UK's international organization for cultural relations and educational opportunities. All opinions expressed by me and the podcast guests are solely ours and does not reflect the opinion or policies of the British Council. For more information about the British Council, go to britishcouncil.org.ng. My guest today is Demi Owoshaje. Demi is a furniture designer, manufacturer. Practically, she makes furniture. And that's an interesting thing for me because that industry is normally dominated by men. Manufacturing and making furniture, as you think about it, is men. And when I learned about what Demi is doing, I really want to talk to her because she's making furniture. She's been doing that for about 4 years in England, and now she's doing something similar and the same in Nigeria. So Demi is here with me now in Lagos, and we're talking about how she got started, what she's doing, and what's the future of this kind of industry, especially to and the implication of that in Africa. So Demi, welcome to Building the Future.
Thank you so much for having me.
It's good to have you, actually. You had a bit of a challenge coming here from the mainland, driving yourself. So first of all, a lot of people that come from England and live in Nigeria, it takes them a bit of a time to navigate and start driving in Nigeria because it's very hectic. Why are you so crazy to get on a car and be driving in Lagos?
Do you know why? I am a bit crazy. I like to throw myself into things. That's how I learned to swim very, very quickly.
Wait, you threw yourself into the water instead of swimming?
That's the analogy I like to make of my life. Anything I've basically done or accomplished is not something that I sort of sit around and ponder on for too long. I'm the type of person I kind of throw in and then figure it out whilst I'm in there. So driving in Lagos basically just stemmed from an experience I had when I first came, which was I did have a car, and I'm very independent in the UK. But over here, I had to wait on a driver, and I had to wait on this, I had to wait on that. So as soon as I decided to come back, the first point of call was, okay, I've got to get myself a car. And then I did also consider getting a driver, but then I heard so many horror stories of them doing this and doing that. I was like, do you know what? I'm more than capable of driving myself. I've got Google. So the moment I realized that Google Maps worked here, I was like, that's it, I'm good to go.
And how do you navigate all the chaotic Lagos Junction when people don't actually most of the time respect the rule of driving on the road? There is an unwritten rule when you're driving in Lagos. How do you get around those kind of rules?
I don't really get around it. I kind of get through it.
How do you actually
I just understand that everybody else on the road is a terrible driver and I'm the best driver on Lagos roads.
That's what everybody thinks.
Yes, it is. And it's the only way for you to get through it. Because if you if you don't anticipate the bad drivers, you will just fall victim. So I just try my hardest to just understand that they can literally make a bad move at any point. How do I need to position myself? What should I be avoiding? And then I just keep going from that point.
So how long have you been in Lagos?
I've been in Lagos now. First time I came over was 2015. I kind of came for a month or so and went back. I've been back now stably since last year, August.
So let's use that Lagos analogy of you coming to Lagos and throwing yourself into the deep end of driving. I believe anybody that's driving in Lagos is actually really, really nativizing themselves in Lagos because you could be an expat or repat, whatever they call it now, and you could actually only be living out not within Lagos because you're living on the island and you're being children driven everywhere.
Yeah.
But for you to actually live on the mainland and you're driving yourself,
yes,
that's well done, sir.
It's bravery.
So let's use that as an analogy for you doing what you're doing now. You studied architecture in the university. You could have been working in an architectural firm and be doing some other, just drawing stuff. But you decided to be a furniture maker. Is that you throwing yourself into the deep end and trying to learn new things?
It is, but let me just kind of give you a bit of a background story into that. So when I graduated from architecture, I graduated at a time where recession had hit the country quite hard.
That's England, right?
In England, yes. It hit the country quite hard. Graduates were coming out of university. There were no work. There was no work for anybody. And, you know, people were going for the same roles. Now, within architecture, being a woman is a minority as it is. And then being a black female was even more difficult. And I remember sort of going through my studies, there was a lot of stereotypes that were made of me. Oh, you're too fancy to be an architect. You may perhaps you're going to, you know, some sort of fashion design or something like
Why?
That.
Why? Is there any kind of a stereotype of architect not looking fancy or nice?
Yeah,
I thought it's a very fancy design profession.
Stuff. But I'm very sort of, I like fashion. I used to go to lectures and put my heels on and I'm ready to go for it and all of that. And I think there's certain stereotypes, but it kind of sort of stemmed from that I'm already a minority, so a lot of these things were sort of working against me, or so I thought. So when I did sort of go into the world of working as an architect, there was no work. So the minority is always going to be the least sorted after individuals within the workforce. So I ended up having to go all the way outside of London to try and find a job. Ended up in a small
practice. What year was this?
I believe this was about 2010, between 2009 and 2010.
I understand that time because that was when I finished my PhD as well. And my PhD was in a field that is hugely related to construction. Mm. So it was an environmental science. And there are two pathways for me. Had I become an academia and be working in a university as a lecturer or researcher, or going to consulting and environmental science, majorly consulting for construction company. And that was the horrible time, the toughest time for you to get a job in construction.
Toughest.
Because people are just being laid off. Mm. They're not taking new people in. And I was actually in a double disadvantage in the sense that they were taking some graduates. I'm not like a graduate because I'm a little bit step high.
Yes,
so they can't employ me because I'm too overqualified and they can't afford me because they were laying off people like me.
Yes.
So I understand that time. So, and actually those times, and I ended up starting my own business.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it'd be like, so I heard from someone that said that some of the best lasting businesses were actually founded during recessions or depression in the 30s.
Mm-hmm. That was basically my story. So, you know, I was working for a firm and they literally put me in a dark room somewhere when I was doing CAD drawings all day long. And obviously when you think about going into architecture, you think it's luxurious, it's fancy, you're doing beautiful buildings. I'm going to one day see my building in the middle of London somewhere. My parents would be so proud, or go to all over the world and tell all their friends, oh my God, my daughter's an architect. But here I was in this dark room doing these terrible drawings, basic council blocks, technical drawings, and I hated it. So I said to myself, and the commute was a nightmare all the way from London to Luton.
Oh, you're working in Luton.
I was commuting to Luton because I couldn't find anything in London, so I was forced to do that. So I decided one day I'm just going to go back to London and start looking for work again. I ended up doing retail for some time and I excelled in retail. It got to the point where they wanted to start training me as some sort of area manager for a high street store. And I just looked at my life and said, really, is that really what I went to university for? To be earning, you know, a certain amount and be working at a clothes store. I'm pretty qualified here.
But it's funny though, you left what you studied and then to work in retail and then
yes.
You were excelling in that.
I was excelling in that,
and
yes.
You had another thing and said, this is not
it career
part.
It just wasn't part of the plan for me. You know, retail is great. As much as I like fashion, I don't want to be selling it.
Which store were you working
I was working
for?
At Reese, so it's quite a high-end sort of high street store. So I was doing that, and then one day something in my mind just had enough. I don't know, I just had come out of a meeting with one of my managers who said, oh yeah, we would like to start the training for you now. We think we can be really great, because I was one of their top salespeople within the store. And I just thought to myself, I said, oh, well, how much are they earning? And he said something along the lines of like £4,000 to £5,000 a year. And you get benefits of clothes. And clothes are great, but
a lot of people are working years to get to that point.
And I'd done it within about a year and a half of working for the company when they were considering me for that. And I just thought, no, it's not really what I wanted. I wanted something more. I want to be able to build something of my own rather than working for somebody. That's the reason why I started architecture, because the plan with that was I want to build my own buildings. I want to start my own firm one day. So I walked out of the store. I literally just turned to my colleagues and I said, I'm going. And they said, okay, see you after lunch. And I said, no, I'm not coming back. They said, what do you mean? I said, no, I can't. I'm so sorry, but I
That's
quit.
Really funny. You were offered promotion and you walked out.
Well, no, technically, I was actually offered training for...
Oh, training.
Offer, yeah, for yeah. potential promotion. They were considering me to go for that, but you've got to go through a series of training and stuff to kind of go through. But it was a scary moment for me because, you know, here I was trying so hard to find a role in architecture and it was saying no to me constantly. And what I was offered just wasn't what I wanted. And here I was excelling in another trade, but I knew within myself it just wasn't for me. So I blindly just walked out, not knowing what I was going to do, because I still hadn't found anything in architecture.
But you have that instinct that this is not what I should be doing. I could do better. Yes. This is okay.
That overwhelming feeling that if I take this, I'm going to be trapped. So I thought, okay, I can't do it. You know when you just feel overwhelmed? Okay, no, it's not for me. So I walked out and I just backed up. I went home, and at the time I was in a relationship, and I said to my partner, he goes, oh, why are you home early? I said, I kind of left my job. And he looked at me like I was the craziest person on the planet. This is recession. People don't leave jobs. What on earth are you doing? And he said to me, so after he got over the anger, he said to me, so what are you going to do? And I said, do you know what? I want to try and do something of my own. He said, what? I said, I don't know yet. I'll figure it out.
That's really scary.
It's yeah. very scary. Because.
But did you have that? Because sometimes entrepreneurs have this self-belief that is not beyond a... It just... It's something that you cannot explain, but you know deep inside
in
it, there's something
yes.
that I need to build
in
that
gut,
needs to be
yes.
done, and I'm the best person to do this. I might not be able to articulate it yet, but it forms and it becomes real. And when I see it, I know it.
I was clueless. I had, honestly, you don't know what it is that it, you can't describe it, but you just have this overwhelming feeling that something is there. I just don't know what to call it yet, but I owe it to myself to go investigate and find out what that thing is.
And you don't know whether it's furniture or whatever.
I
just
knew
you
no
had to
idea.
Build something.
I
so
just
you never had
it.
Which is a good way as well sometimes to start a business. Okay, I've always been passionate about getting X or building X, and I'm aligning myself to do that, and everything, my conversation as I want to build X. And there are some other people that found businesses by, she said, I want to build a business. I don't know what it is, but I'm looking for where opportunities aligns with my passion or my interest, and they build something. But you were quite different. Is I want to do something. I don't know what it is, but I know this is not, that one is not
it's
it.
Not it,
and
yes.
I want to start something. So what did you do next?
So next, I just kind of got on with life. I was sitting at home, as usual, sit on the internet looking for things.
Watching TV?
I didn't really watch too much telly, but I remember that period of my life just sitting there staring at the TV, just looking, thinking like, just hit me with the idea already. Give me something. Give me some sort
You're
of
looking for ideas?
You know when you're just staring into like nothing and you're just waiting for something to hit you? Those times in your life, you do pray an awful lot. And one of the things that kind of push your prayer is, oh, just give me a sign. God, just give me a sign of what it is I'm supposed to be doing. Because what I thought I should have been doing all these years, architecture, isn't necessarily happened yet. If there's something else, I'm open. Just give it to me already. But I know what I didn't want. And then one day, it was just really, really random because me and my sister, we went shopping for groceries. And at the time, I thought, let me just buy some furniture for the house or whatever. And I'd been looking online and I found like a Chesterfield sofa.
A Chesterfield sofa, a kind of antique vintage sofa.
Yes,
that
leather.
Large leather. Big reach.
The
and it's something
British.
I love. You British?
Yeah, it's a British.
Familiar
it's
with.
Actually the only known British, originally British piece of upholstered furniture.
How old is it?
I believe the Chesterfield's been around since the early 1800s, I believe.
Is that a brand? The
no,
family
actually,
that started doing it? Or
right,
it's just...
so it stems from the Earl of Chesterfield. We're just going to look a quick background. Earl of Chesterfield, which he basically commissioned somebody to make him a nice piece of upholstered furniture for sort of like a meeting area where people just come in, they meet and then leave. So it's not to be used for daily use. It was just like a statement of wealth. So somebody was commissioned to do that and they made it, and it was named after the Earl of Chesterfield. So the name of the design stems from that. But Chesterfield itself is a design, not a brand. It's not... You know,
it's a type of design for...
Yeah, it's a type of... Yeah, so furniture. A type of upholstered furniture.
So you saw that?
I saw that and I said to my partner, oh, let's buy one for the house. It'd be so nice. And he said, oh, it's so expensive. And we ended up buying it anyway. I managed to convince him. We bought it.
How much was it?
It was something like £600.
Yeah, like
yeah, it was a second. It was a fairly used one. We found it on like Gumtree or something. We bought it and it came home and he saw it and he said, "Oh, it's nice." I saw it and I said, "It's disgusting. I hate
After
it."
After you bought it, you After felt it's disgusting.
Something I just knew it wasn't original. It wasn't an original Chesterfield. And what we had been looking for was an original antique. And it had been advertised as an original antique, but I just knew, you know, I just have that natural eye. And I knew my leather. I don't know where I got that eye from, but I just knew my leather. And I said, it's not real. It's not 100% animal hide. We have to replace it. And he was just like, oh, you've started again with your drama.
After
we paid £600. And he said to me, how on earth are we going to sell it? So I said, don't worry, I'll figure it out. So back to the day with me and my sister, who's actually here today with us. We were shopping. We went to Sainsbury's, I believe, and on, you know, you go to the shopping centre sometimes, you see like a notice board. Somebody had posted on a notice board that they were selling a Chesterfield suite. And I looked at it and it was an antique red. And I said to her, oh my God. She was like, isn't that the sofa you wanted? I was like, yeah. So I thought, let me get the number of the lady. And luckily she was local. So I called her and we ended up going to her house. And now at the time I was only looking for one sofa. She had a set. She had like a 4 or 5 piece set. And I said to her, I only need one. She said, no, you've got to take them all. If you want them, I can't sell them pieces because they come as a set. You either take them all or you don't take them at all. So I said, oh God, how much is it? She said, £300.
For the set?
For the set.
And you bought one piece for
£600. I was like, huh? That doesn't add up. But I was like, okay, well, and it's really funny because at the time when she said 300, I had no money. The 300 I had in my account, I think I had £350 in my account. And that was my last paycheck from my last job that I walked out of. And she said, are you really going to buy it? I said, oh, I'm going to have to buy it. Just for that one piece, I have to buy it. What are you going to do with the rest? I said, I'll figure it out. So I bought it, called my partner and said, oh, babe, can we get a van? He goes, what for? I said, of course, I just bought a Chesterfield set. He goes, are you barking mad? We already have one. I said, but this one's an original. Trust me. I just kept saying, trust me. So he did trust me. He got a van. We picked it up. We got it to the house. We had a very tiny flat in Stratford. And we got it to the house and he said, what on earth are we going to do with all of this? I said, okay, the same place we bought the first one we bought, I'm going to put these on there and sell them on there. We're bound to get something for it. So we put it on Gumtree. And within a couple of days, some people called. Hey, would you come? I said, yeah, you've got to come to my house, have a look at it. They came, they saw, they bought.
For how much?
For £950.
So you made like £650 profit.
From the set that I just
from
bought.
From the set you just bought.
£300. But then remember, we also sold the original one we bought for £600.
Your first one, you sold that one as
we
well?
We sold that one. We also sold
the same for six, for,
but no,
the
no,
same
we sold night. It for more.
You sold it for more?
We sold that one for £250 more than what we bought it for. So we had £250 profit from the first one. We then had, I think it was 9 months, £650 profit from the second set.
Yeah.
And then we were left with the one that we originally wanted. And not only did they buy it, they didn't actually take it there and then. They trusted us to deliver it later. So I'm looking at my partner, he's looking at me, we're holding cash.
And you've sold all the sets?
We sold all the set, but we kept one. The original.
You kept one from that set?
From the set.
The one that you already didn't want. So not only did you sell that set for more, for £650, you also sold less of it. So you took one out of that. That's
took one out of
pretty
it, yes.
good business.
Very good business.
Without doing anything.
Well, a little bit of picture taking, a little editing, putting it on.
Yeah.
A lot of time invested, very little time invested on posting these things online. So we did that, and then we just stood there, looked at each other, and obviously this is the man who said I was barking mad before, and now he's looking, thinking, oh, this is quite interesting little turnout. Should we get more? It was actually his idea, so should we buy another one? I was like, yeah, I think we should. Let's try it again and see if this works. So we did it, and within 3 months, we had a whole house full of Chesterfield furniture.
You're just going out, and at that point, you started having high for good Chesterfield. You know how to price it.
Actually, we didn't, because when we first started, we only used to put a little bit of profit on top. The first set, obviously, because it was a collection, it made quite a lot of money. So when we started then sort of thinking, like, okay, let's try and get more, we started to put little bits of profit on top of them. Then I started doing some homework and said, okay, well, surely if I buy these cheaper, my profit margin will be higher.
Yeah.
So we started.
So your first one was just lucking out.
We thought it was just luck. We thought, oh, we've just been really lucky here. I've got my money back. He's happy. I'm happy. Let's try and do it again. And then we started doing it and starting it out. And then, you know, the process started taking us further and further out of London. At that stage, we then found that, okay, we started renting a van. We will shop online throughout the week. And on the weekends, we'll take a van and we'll travel out places like Northampton, Wales, we go as far as Scotland sometimes.
So anyone that posts Chesterfield online,
I would buy it.
You buy it. But then where do you sell it?
The same place.
How does that work? So I'm looking for Chesterfield. I saw that. I mean, I know things stay for a longer time on eBay or Gumtree. And I'm seeing Chesterfield for £300. Okay?
Yes.
And then 3 weeks after, I'm seeing the same Chesterfield for £600. Why would I buy
it? That's just it, though. When we first started, you would have seen the same thing. But then my brain started telling me that I have to spruce this up, which is where the editing comes into it. So what I used to do is I would take my own photos. I'll take them in great lighting because a lot of the products we were buying, they were cheap because people were not photographing them well.
Because they just want to get rid of it.
They just want to get rid of it. They don't understand the value in what they're selling. So when we started doing some research ourselves, we started seeing the big boy players in what we were doing. And we recognized what they were doing. What they were basically doing, they were restoring. They would buy a sofa that was in bad condition. They would restore it and sell it for profit. So I started saying to myself, okay, well, how can I get my stuff restored? So I started looking for somebody to help me restore them. So we buy them. We'll clean them up. Sometimes they have tears in them, in the leather. Sometimes they had no leather at all. Sometimes the leather was just really, really dirty. So I had a company that would come out to the flat and would help me clean my leather pieces. And then I'll sell it for profit. So after a while, common sense kind of just said to me, well, couldn't you do what they're doing if you applied yourself a little bit? So I used to watch them. It started off me watching them. Then I advanced watching to videoing them. I started recording what they were doing.
You record what they're doing and you're looking at what they're actually doing.
So step by step.
What did they do actually? So they look at just a few days, cracks and lots of white pieces coming out. Mm-hmm. I see a lot of that and pops and stuff. So let's say you get one of those. What would they do? Would it
so the first thing they'll do is they'll clean it because leather is like skin. It's like a lot full of oil. So you have to extract all the dirt and oil for it in order for you to start on a clean plate. So they'll first clean it well. And then they'll look at the area in which the leather has been destroyed. A lot of the time they use microscopes to kind of study the leather properly. They'll then sort of use sort of chemicals and products to try and patch up areas where the colour had perhaps been leaving the leather. If something is a cut, they'll use a sub-material at the bottom of it to hold it back together and then treat the surface to blend it in with the rest of the piece. So all these things I was taking it in. Then I started sort of recording the products that they were using. And leather trade is a very secret industry. It's not something you can just go online and tell you how to do these things.
Is it? It's been steeped in tradition and apprenticeship and people learning.
Back to what you were saying about me being a woman doing a man's job, a lot of the men who did this stuff were old white men in a shed somewhere or in a workshop somewhere. They weren't in public eye. It's not like a high street store. You see them working on furniture. So it was trade secrets, essentially, what I was capturing on my camera. So I started looking into it. I thought, this is really, really good
stuff. Do they know you are recording?
Do you know what? They didn't. I must admit they did not. And that was a little a bit cheeky of me, but that's just what I had to do at the time in order for me to try and teach myself.
Because you cannot get a permission to come into their little club. So
no,
just badging
you have
yourself.
To. These are traditional things that they've passed on to their children and workers and over a long period of time. It's not, I can't go to the library and find how to restore leather. If I'm lucky, I might find something, but it doesn't tell me the full story. So that was the quickest way for me to learn. And what I didn't learn from them, I picked up on YouTube to bridge the gaps. And obviously then I started advancing to contacting companies and saying, hi, I'm a fellow business owner. Could you possibly tell me, I'm trying to achieve this with my leather. Can you possibly tell me what products I could choose? And so through doing that, and it's funny because businesses who are doing these things, they will help you.
Yeah, of course.
It's always wise to ask the questions you don't know. They will help you. Even the guys I was recording, although they didn't know I was recording them, whenever I asked them questions, they were more than happy to say, oh yeah, this is, you've got to take your time with this one every stage, wait 6 hours before you put the next coat and blah, blah, blah. So in essence, they were helping me. So we got through that part. And then eventually I said, okay, I need to basically make myself an expert now. That's when I started going to the schools where I paid a little bit of money and I got all the trade secrets.
Is that a school for people to learn how to restore Chesterfield?
Well, it's actually out of one of the companies that I contacted asking for help, and every other week I'll call them, oh, hey Demi, how are you? They started knowing me now. Oh, they'd never seen me face to face. Every time I called and asked questions, oh, hi, how's it going? I was like, okay, yeah, I'm really trying to do this and that. Why don't you go to the training where we trained? And I was like, oh, really? And they were like, yeah, just contact this lady, give her name is June or whatever, and she'll tell you all the details. So I eventually went to the leather training school and then discovered what I was doing wrong, what I was doing right, and how to refine my skills a little bit. So that's how the business then started stabilizing.
And in the meantime, you're still buying from online and selling and restoring and selling. So you're making a bit of profit there.
A lot of profit.
A lot of profit. What's the margin we're talking about here?
I could, you know, with this type of furniture, it's because not many people understand the value in what they have a lot of the time with antiques. you know, sometimes, like you said, they just want to get rid of it. Or something has a small tear, and, oh, that's it, it's finished, there's nothing can be done. So they'll put it online for £25. A whole sofa for £25.
Chesterfield.
A Chesterfield, yes. And I look at that and thinking, well, it's all the way in Scotland, so I've got to obviously invest a little bit of time and energy to go and get it. But once I've done that, I get it into my studio, I follow my steps, I refine it. If I need to, I can go as far as changing the entire colour.
Oh, you can?
Yes, I can go as far as changing the entire colour. So, and I put it back online, advertise it, people will come. That £25 sofa could fetch me £2,000.
What?
Yes.
That's a big margin.
Yes, but obviously you spend a little
bit. You spend some more time.
And money doing it.
Well, of course, you should be going on with about 60% margin.
Very good margins, yeah.
So you're doing a bit of that. You don't have any challenge with demand for Chesterfield so far? While you started moving away from not just online or eBay and stuff, you're now having your own website.
We created a website probably about 6 to 8 months in. We thought, okay, there has to be somewhere they can go. Because the problem with advertising to people on other platforms like Gumtree and eBay is that sometimes they might suspect it might be a scam, and then you're competing with a lot of people on there as well. Your stuff doesn't tend to stand out properly. You can't.
But then it's a big platform.
It's a huge platform. We were selling quite a lot on that platform. But then we decided, okay, we want to now be a proper business, get registered, do all the necessary things. And if we wanted to demand more money, we had to have our own platforms. That's when we decided to do our own website.
So it's interesting that you got yourself into an industry that you wouldn't have actually if you had a plan.
Yes.
That's not something that you're going to write in your plan, that I want to be a Chesterfield restorer.
Yes, who says that?
It's just, except you know, if your dad is doing that and you don't imagine. Yes. It's not a business that you can actually study and not imagine. Mm-hmm. You just stumbled into it, kind of. So when you not learned, you went to the school and you started, now you launched your own business. So tell me how, because there's a bit of challenge that is different from somebody who is just doing something freelance in their house and making a couple of hundred dollars or pounds to somebody who's saying, okay, this is me, this is what I do, this is my business, I'm investing time and money and making it big. Tell me about the changes that happened when you now registered it and you are now having your own website and you're having a big studio.
Now, I think for me at that point it was a bit of a reality check. We got to the point where we're now going to be held accountable for our processes, paying taxes, we're just doing a website. So there are now demands from us because we're now a proper company. Whereas before, I'm just a girl in my flat. I bought something. I was lucky enough to have somebody come over and buy it and give me some money for it. And I've kept all my money. Now I own the tax man a part of that process now. I'm having to now record everything and do things the proper way. And then obviously that eats into your profits, especially when business is also down. There's still certain responsibilities you have to pay. And then it got to the point where we said, okay, we can't keep doing this from home. We have to obviously invest money in the space. And furniture demands a lot of space. So
did you still have to hire people at that point as well?
We weren't hiring people just yet.
So when you say we, what
it was me and my partner.
Oh, he actually was working on this.
He was basically helping out on the weekends.
Okay,
He didn't quit his job. He carried on doing that. So the Chesterfield stuff, at the beginning we thought we were just lucky. This is just luck. Come on, how long can we sustain this for? But then the more I kind of went further and further into it, I started realizing that, okay, certain things will change, but ultimately I still have a good business model here. So it's really my responsibility to try and scale it as much as I possibly could.
And what were your ideas of scaling it? What steps did you take to scale that boutique, mom and pop?
I started creating a brand. I created my logo. Then I started, what do I want to call myself? What do I want to stand for? Who are my clientele? What type of things do they like to see? What kind of places do they hang out? I started studying my market a lot more. And by studying my market, I then started realizing that, okay, I have a real opportunity here. It's now quite a critical point for me to sort of, okay, how do I then turn things around from just a girl doing her hobby on the side to really be respected as a brand? And the moment I started doing that, I started then noticing the type of clientele I was getting. I was getting the VIPs. I was getting places like Clarence House. I was,
Clarence House were ordering your furniture.
They ordered something from us, yes. And we...
And they discovered you through your website or through the events?
It's just a lot. I think marketing was key. So we'll have our own website. We'll go out with flyers and things like that in our local area and post it to houses.
In areas that you think people want to buy this kind
of
furniture?
In areas that we thought, places like Dorston, kind of that traditional part of East London. We were targeting our clientele.
You're targeting Dalston. I thought most people live in Dalston. Except in the new flats in Dalston.
Dalston has a lot of hidden places. Places
that are
like
quite rich.
In East London who are very wealthy, yes.
I would have thought that you would be targeting Islington and...
Islington is very close to Dalston.
Or maybe the usual suspect.
Like. I remember as well that the more studying we did of our client, we realized that a lot of the people who were buying from us, they had a certain demographic as well. So when we deliver to them, we were privileged to see, oh, wait a minute, I've never seen this road before. This is quite an affluent road in the middle of somewhere that you never suspect. So our eyes were being opened up to these things. The more we went in it, the more we were discovering that we didn't know a lot.
And then people would talk to their friends.
Then we
as
had
well.
Referrals and things like that. The next minute we had calls from Jimmy Choo, fashion designers who wanted, because what we're doing as well is we've discovered that people wanted furniture for short-term.
For photo ops?
Yeah, for photo opportunities. They wanted it for fashion shows. They wanted it for private parties, a lot of offices.
So instead of discovering different use cases for your product?
For our product. The client, we had a clientele of our clients used our products for different things.
How are you then engaging with your clients? So some of them discover you online. So you then have like an email list and you're writing to them every time about your new product line.
We were building data. We were collecting information about who our clients were. And we were discovering, because a lot of the time we were privileged to enter their homes. They become friends, a lot of our clients will enter their homes and you kind of build rapport with people and they start telling you things. Oh my God, my friends will love your stuff. Please call them. This is their contact details. And a lot of referrals were coming through. So it's just that what we did with that information is what really, really made that turn for us.
What were your major competitions?
We started discovering our major competitions, which were a lot of companies who were outside of London who were making Chesterfields were a lot of our companies.
Well, some of them were old companies, right? Established 1854.
Well, it's funny because, without mentioning names, there's a Chesterfield company in England. It's been there since 1718. And they've somehow copyrighted the word Chesterfield.
They copyrighted into Chesterfield?
They've kind of claimed it as one of the originals. So we were looking to people like that, not necessarily as competition, but we're looking to them for influence. We're looking to them for some sort of ideas, at a target, something to try and aim towards.
Yeah.
Obviously, they've been doing this stuff for a very, very
long
time.
So they'll have a lot of premiums, so you can then go a little bit lower than them. Is that how you're undercutting them? Or you're undercutting them?
It's actually funny because what they did for us... What they did for us was help us realize that we were undercharging for our service. We were doing more research and we discovered these people were selling things for thousands. And it's really funny, what we even discovered was that a lot of the places we were buying our furniture from, they were also buying their furniture.
They were buying their furniture from people as well and restoring it. Is there anyone making Chesterfield from scratch?
Oh yeah, they are. 1718 makes their Chesterfields from scratch. There's other companies who also, because what they started doing is a lot of people, what they do is they will sell antiques, but they also make new. So they were doing the two. Old and new, a nice blend, which is the direction we started then going into, that we can blend old and new.
So you started making your furniture at some point as well, from scratch.
Within 2 years, we started making.
So how many people did you employ at that point?
At that point, we had two carpenters and upholsterers are working with us, and everything else was outsourced.
What do you mean everything else was outsourced?
So, for instance, if we need somebody that is going to make our legs, we didn't employ him to make our legs. We simply outsourced it to a company to do that for us. If we want somebody to provide our cushions and our fillings, we'll outsource that, and then they just deliver it. We put everything together.
So what do you do then? Obviously, you now know how to restore. Do you then get into the workshop and start making things yourself, restoring or...
Yes.
You learn how to do carpentry?
I learned
carpentry.
All that stuff. I don't do carpentry. No, I don't actually physically get the wood and cut it together. My role set in essence is I do the designs of what we want or the changes to alterations to what we've possibly got in stock. I then basically then do the leather restoring, which is the colouring. So I'm the colour technician, I'm the restorer, the person who fixes all the cuts and bruises to the leather, and then the person who does all the fillings and stuff here and there, where we need to. Everything else is built by the carpenters, and then the upholsterers do the stitching on all the other major parts of the furniture.
And you also do the selling as well?
And I do the selling and marketing, yes.
And you're the face of the company?
I am, yes.
So this company was now growing 2 years, and you were part of the Prince's Trust?
Yeah, so when we decided we needed more space, we wanted to move to a bigger, sort of space and workshop. That's when we then went to the Prince's Trust and said, hi, we are Majors Chesterfield.
So Prince's Trust is, just for some of our listeners that are not familiar with it, it was a charity started by Prince Charles.
Yes.
And the idea is to encourage young people to go into entrepreneurship by giving them mentorship and sometimes grants
and funding
to do so. So you went to Princess Trust and said, yes. Hey, we are young people and we do Chesterfield restoration, which is quite antique and young.
Yes, I think, but at that point we got on quite a lot of media attention.
How did you get
one day, number 10 Downing Street called us and said, we'd like to invite you down. We've seen some of your work online. We think it's really superb what you're doing.
How did you get to the place where number 10 Downing Street noticed what you're doing?
When you have clients who share your stuff on social media and they're more than happy to tell other people what they've discovered.
Plus, you're a woman of color, a young lady doing...
I'm a complete opposite of what I should be in that industry. So I think that in itself gained us quite a bit of attention. And once people are like, oh, there's a young black woman who's making, you know, restoring furniture and she's doing it for certain people, we would like to know more. What's, how is she actually doing this? And, you know, a lot of young people at the time, they tend to go into more hippie, younger technology, things like that, and here I am doing something very, very old-fashioned. So people just naturally were curious. So when we were invited to number 10 down the street, that was our opportunity to basically tell our story. So it's a great platform. So once people heard our story, it was like, oh my god, we want to know more. And then we were then asked by Clarence House to host an event for Prince Charles in our office. So we put that together and we invited him down and he came and...
And he was just coming to see...
He was coming to see Major Chesterfield, yes.
Now, how awesome was that to have the prince, the heir to the throne of England, coming to your studio?
It was epic.
That's it. Where was the studio at this point?
We're basically in Bermondsey.
Okay. That's not like East London.
No, it's not East London. We're more south.
Yeah.
Southeast.
And then you drove with his... So you have some security guy come in.
The whole place was shut down.
Shut down.
So they came like days prior to do security checks.
And ask you lots of questions about you.
Yes. They wanted to know who I was, wanted to know who my family members were, what they did. So MI5 stuff, it was pretty serious. And we weren't even allowed to tell anybody he was coming. Everybody just saw this entourage of security and stuff turn up.
You cannot tell your parents that he's
That wasn't meant to, but
you told
come
your parents.
On, I had to tell my mum to put on that special dress, didn't I?
And she came as if she was working in your store as well.
My goodness, she came ready.
I can imagine.
She was ready. And it's really fun. My mum's called Elizabeth and my dad's called Charles.
Interesting.
Very. So when I saw, obviously they were prepared. And then that morning, the whole building was then like, what's going on? Who's coming? But I think at that stage, they knew something big.
Somebody big is coming.
Something big was coming. And then he turned up and then I kind of, you know, welcomed him. And then I took him upstairs to the office. And then we sat down and other young entrepreneurs were also invited to sort of showcase some of the stuff that they do as well, just to kind of get that conversation.
But you were the one hosting it.
I was hosting it, yes. So we sat down, I sat with him and, you know, the press and everybody was there. And we asked him a series of questions. And he made some suggestions for Major Chesterfield.
Because he's a Chesterfield lover himself.
He loves Chesterfield. When he heard our story, he wanted to meet me in person because I think, because he has such a great love for leather and, you know, sort of British made products, he was quite impressed that a young person was doing something like that. So his best advice for me was never stop making homegrown stuff. Like, stay true to, you know, how your processes are and never change that. Made in Britain stuff at the time, obviously, and it still is very much part of the conversation we're having in the country about how to grow our economy. And that's basically what we're trying to do in Nigeria too.
What was the impact of that visit on your business?
I couldn't tell you. It was like a flip overnight.
Was it?
Yes, because by that stage, everybody in London knew who pretty much Major Chesterfield was. Anybody remotely interested in Chesterfields. And even if you didn't know what Chesterfield was, I was that girl who did...
Chesterfields.
I was that girl who did the button sofa. And that definitely helped our business. And I think then approaching the market and sending newsletters out to our clients who hadn't bought.
And then they see that it's been endorsed by the prince.
It's been endorsed by the prince. And then following from that, you know, number 10 Downing Street. But at that stage, it was quite...
Number 10 Downing Street ordered some of your stuff as well.
No, it was funny enough. They actually wanted us to restore some furniture. They had a chair for Winston Churchill that they wanted us to restore.
That would have been interesting.
It would have been interesting, but the family then changed their mind. They didn't want to restore it anymore.
The family?
Yes, they decided to keep it.
The family of Winston Churchill had a chair in number 10 Downing Street that Winston Churchill used to sit on.
It was his main
and
chair.
Number 10 Downing Street was thinking of restoring it, but the family said, no, we want it to keep it the way it is.
Yes.
It is. Okay. So you got a lot of press attention, a lot of media mention, and then just tell me how, because a lot of people listening to this are entrepreneurs who want to do something similar or want to take advantage of media attention. How did you utilize that or not?
to be honest with you, I probably hold media solely responsible for the way my business took and how we've managed to grow so quickly and how we've managed to do so well so quickly, because a lot of people are doing what we are doing. You just don't see them. And it's critical when you're trying to scale a business. You need visibility. You know, in a world where information is so quick and rapid now, if you're not in the race, you will quickly get left behind, because people see that as authentication nowadays, don't they?
But some people can have that kind of attention and then not do anything with it.
Don't do with it, yes.
And so what steps did you take?
Consistency is big for me. I always make sure that we're consistent. As much as we're marketing the product, we're also marketing the brand. Always make sure we're in constant communication with our clients, both past and present, and then obviously future, as much as we can. And just giving that knowledge, just sharing our knowledge, because content is so, so important. And everything we're doing at every stage, we're trying as much as possible to carry people along and just to try and remain visible in everything that we're doing. So, you know, consistency. You can be visible one day and then tomorrow you're nowhere to be seen again because you've not kept that momentum going.
So your business is not a typical business that we talk to, because we talk to people who are using technology to scale, and the keyword is scale. Your business doesn't look like something that you really want to scale and be producing thousands and millions.
It didn't start off like that, because remember, we started off as a niche. Mm-hmm. We grew so quickly and we became so well known because we were a niche. A small group of people thought we were interesting and they wanted to keep us small so that only they can enjoy us. And moving into the Nigerian market, that model is different.
So so before we go to the Nigerian market, so you knew that the business you're doing in England has to be niche. What now made you to come to Africa in the first, and then what's happening to the business in England at the moment?
So in England, we're pretty much kind of stabilized a little bit. We've gone solely online. We don't have a shop front per se anymore, because obviously I'm not there to sort of service that. But clients who are interested in our products can go on our website and they can purchase, and then obviously the guys over there will take care of logistics.
And you're still buying from...
We still buy, yes.
From Gumtree and Restore.
We've kind of advanced a little bit away from Gumtree. We have full-time suppliers now. We have people who actually find things for us.
Okay.
And bring it to us, for us.
And then you buy from them.
We buy from them.
So it's now online. People go online to your website, mm-hmm. and they can order just feel ready-made.
Yes.
Or they can commission one to be done for them.
That's correct, yes.
And then they get it delivered to their house.
That's correct.
That pretty look like... a business that can scale as long as your supply chain is matching the demand. So you have a distribution channel, and it's a bit like sofa.com, but niche.
A niche version of it, yes.
Sofa.com. Okay. Yes. So, and then you have to build an e-commerce platform. People can pay online.
They can pay online.
And you have a customer service. It's still, because your ticket size is huge, so it's still, you're not selling volume, you're actually selling quality. Mm-hmm. And that's a pretty business model. How much were you making at that point? Was like, can you give it a rough
estimate? Probably sort of turnaround and over probably in excess of 150,000 per year.
Okay, so that's pretty decent and good. Why did you decide to come to Nigeria?
All right, so one of the reasons why I decided to come over is because this conversation started about opportunities in Africa and how Africa was changing. Now, although I'd visited Nigeria before, I didn't see the Nigeria that everybody had been talking about.
Well, your parents were from Nigeria originally.
They were born
in the UK.
No, I was born in Nigeria, and I went over to the UK when I was very, very young, before I even have any memory of Nigeria. So when I then visited Nigeria, it was like, very much new to me. And I was just like, this is very, very strange. But I had no real preconceptions and things like that. So when this conversation started in the UK about people doing great things in Nigeria and things changing and young people coming back, and you know that period where it's Christmas and all your friends are missing, where are they? Oh, they're in Lagos.
Everybody is that what happened to you?
All your friends.
You just had somebody in Lagos working with one company and doing stuff.
Like, what are they doing in Lagos? Everybody's enjoying Lagos. I thought, I'm going to go to Lagos and check out what's really happening. So I came over, and that was the first time I'd actually seen the Nigeria that everybody had been talking about. So this is actually quite fun. The weather is great. The people are friendly.
Oh, is that your impression?
That was my second impression, because I was more exposed at that point. I was much older. But when I first came over, I was 14 years old, and it was, you know, you're 14, you kind of pretty much, you know, guided by your parents, aren't you? You don't really get to go out anywhere. So when I came over in, I think it was 2012 or thereabouts, I thought, let me just have a look. And I had a lot of fun. So I thought, well, why not? So my parents had been saying, you know, you should take your business to Africa. Take your business home. Go and show everybody what I'm doing there. They'll love it. They'll buy it. And obviously you don't take them seriously, do you? So when I did come over again in 2015, and I kind of said to myself, well, let's do a little bit of feasibility studies and find out what's really going on in Nigeria in terms of the furniture market. And I discovered that such a huge gap compared to what we have back in London. So many companies doing so many brilliant things, and getting furniture is so easy. Like, why is it over here? It just seemed to be so much of a chore. You go to a store, the options are not really there. You don't really find what you're looking for. You don't have to turn to the guy on the road.
Especially high-end quality stuff. Because you can easily go to the street and buy furniture for less than £500 or dollars. And the guy will make it for you and actually make it for you. Yes. But when you're looking at abandon, it's not going to be good. It's poorly designed.
The longevity of it.
And it's just something is not right with it. But it's talking about the high-end one, people normally actually do import.
I heard that and I thought that was crazy. Why on earth are you importing furniture?
Because we don't have the quality. And
based on what we were doing in the UK, I thought, well, I've got the inside knowledge. It's really not that difficult to make good quality furniture. We're doing it and we're doing it relatively easy. So I think it's just having the eye and then that design sense as well. It's not really that
good. So what did you do? The first step that you took to actually address that?
Okay, so the first thing I did when I came to Nigeria and I decided, okay, I'm going to try this out, is I went looking for a workshop where they made furniture, and I wanted to ask questions. I wanted to know where they buy the materials. I wanted to know their process. I wanted to know who was making the furniture in essence and how they were doing it. I even went as far as visiting a factory for one of the major furniture makers in Nigeria, the indigenous ones outside of Lagos. And I sat with them and I asked them a series of questions, and they were a little bit standoffish of sharing some information with me, but I can be quite persuasive. So I got some information out of them, and I discovered a lot of the things that they said were actually indigenous were actually just been coupled in Nigeria. So they were made abroad, in essence, the major components, and then brought to Nigeria and then assembled.
Okay.
That's basically what they were doing.
And they were selling their high-end furniture.
They were selling them. And even then, I thought, well, although they are strong pieces of furniture, and I don't want to mention the names of the companies I'm talking about, although they were pretty solid and it will last a certain amount of time, they were lacking in designs. They were lacking in that sort of the flexibility of design that I'm pretty much used to where I'm from, where, you know what's in vogue. Everything looked the same with theirs. Very boxy, very old-fashioned. Wasn't enticing at all. And then I looked at the price points and I thought, well, if you're going to pay that much, then what's the point if that's all you're going to get? So I thought, well, let me try and make something first, not all talk. Let me try and make something. So I started going to these local workshop and asking them, okay, where do I buy materials from? Where do I get my foam? Where do I get my wood? Where do I get my fiber? Where do I get my legs and all of that and all of the, my hinges? And I went to those places. I went to the markets. I bought things. I found myself a space. I got guys who were willing to try and help. And I said, okay, I want us to make this. And they looked at me and I'm like, oh, this one is easy. They underestimated the work. Now I said, I want you to make this, but make it the way I tell you to make it. So for several weeks, we stayed in this workshop and we cut wood, we cut fabric, we cut foam. And it was quite frustrating because in essence, I thought I was telling them how to do their jobs. These are experienced carpenters and upholsterers. Some left because they didn't want to listen to me. This black little girl coming from the UK speaking for Ne.
Yeah, and telling us what to do.
Telling us what to do and condemning our work. So some left and one or two stayed and we continued. By the end of the process, I wasn't necessarily happy with what we'd done. So we just carried on doing it until we got it right. And then I think somebody heard that I was in town and they were like, oh, I would like to make some furniture. Could you make something for me? And I was just like, oh, I haven't got my workforce yet, but do you know what?
This person knew about you from England.
They knew about me from England, yes. And I was like, I haven't got my workforce yet. It's literally just me trying to navigate around. But you know what? One of my mentors said that you never say no to a job. You take it and you figure out how to do it later. So that's in essence what I did. I took the job and they wanted me to basically make furniture for their entire flat. And I did that. and they loved it.
And it was good money.
It was decent money. It wasn't fantastic, but in essence, it was my first real project here and I had something to prove. And it was obviously a challenge for me, but I got it done and they were happy. And funny enough, I wasn't happy with it because I felt we could have done much better. But it was the first and you are going to have those testing ones, aren't you?
Because you're working with a new crew,
a new process. Yes, I'm working with new materials. You know, the materials aren't the same as what they are. The foam isn't the same. The fabrics ain't the same.
And in that time, your business in the UK was still going on. Running it and at what?
I can run it online because I've kind of put things in a way that it's easy for me to access a lot of. Obviously, as long as I have internet, I can talk to my clients. I can contact the workshops and say, okay, we've got this order.
That's quite good because you're doing something similar to 4-hour work week that Tim Ferriss wrote about, that you can actually run a good business just spending 3 hours working on it after you got a process, you outsource, you give people responsibility.
That's correct, yes.
And you allow them to do things well, you empower them to make decisions.
On their own. So that's a big lesson to learn for anybody in business because it's very difficult to let go. So it was testing time for me to leave the UK and be telling people from a distance, okay, do this. When things go wrong, what do you then do? Well, you have to give them the opportunity to fix it and correct those things. So that's basically what we did.
So you started in Nigeria with that. Somebody commissioned you to do the flat. And now what happened afterwards?
Well, they got me another client.
You got another client. And so they building more client base since 2015. Mm-hmm. So how many client base have we got now in Nigeria?
Oh, wow. Now we do sort of B2C, but a lot of our business now is actually B2B.
You're working for businesses.
We do work for interior designers.
For hotels that want...
We've not done hotels directly, but what we do, we work with the interior designers who are commissioned to do those jobs. So it's pretty much, you know, architects, interior designers, people like that.
How do you get jobs?
How do we get jobs in Nigeria?
Because I ask that question because business development in Nigeria is different from the UK, right?
Yes.
So what are the difference to you?
I think the time we're at the moment, everybody's having this conversation about technology and social media. And in essence, that's what we've used. We have used social media in Nigeria to try and gain a little bit of attention. And we've been lucky because we have a track record that people can look back to and say, oh, well, they're not just new. They may be new in Nigeria, but they've got history somewhere. And we're very good at using social media. We're very interactive. We basically carry along our entire process. So if you go on our Instagram, for instance, you can pretty much see how we select materials, how our guys are actually working on them live to the finished product.
So you're really leveraging on that.
We are. We're showing you because I think one of the problems of Nigerian standards and finishing in general is transparency. People don't think these things are transparent. You don't know how they're making your furniture. So when it falls apart, you're left in the dark. Whereas I'm showing you how I'm making my furniture. I'm showing you what makes my furniture different from what you probably buy on the roadside. And, you know, why my designs are much nicer and I'm building things properly. I'm using the right materials. I'm not compromising on, you know, my wood. I'm treating my wood. I'm doing this, I'm doing that.
What are the biggest learning sticking point or learning curve that you have to go through? Someone who's running a business, who had run businesses in the UK and now running business in Nigeria?
I think it's the transition. Sometimes we can get so stuck in our comfort zones and we don't want to adapt. And that is a challenge because I have that challenge here when I'm like, oh God, you know, I don't have to experience this in London. You know, I have a challenge. I know who to go to in London. Here it's, I don't know where to turn. I'm literally at the mercy of people wanting to help or people sharing the information that I could otherwise find online if I was in the UK. But it also strengthens you and you build resilience that you never knew you even had. I never would have thought to myself, you know, 5 years ago, I'd be in Lagos, not only running a business, but doing it well. You know, I think resilience is definitely the biggest thing I've learned moving here. But challenges, like, you know, everyday challenges, light obviously is an issue for anybody trying to run a business here. But the only way it's going to get better is if we get involved.
How many people work in your studio in Nigeria now?
At the moment, as of yesterday, we have 14 employees.
We have more employees in the UK, in Nigeria than in the UK.
I do, yes.
Is it because labor is cheaper?
Well, nobody wants to say it, but it's the truth. Labor is much cheaper and there isn't so much red tape. as there is in the UK. So I pay my workers, they go about their business. We do what we need to do. In the UK, it's very, very difficult to try. By the time you get to the point where you're employing 14 individuals, you know your overheads are telling you.
Yeah, I know that. Mm-hmm. I've got that before in my previous startup, where you look at how much money you've got in the bank, you look at how much you have to pay at the end of the month. And so let's quickly talk about your business now, and where do you see it going to? What are the key things that you see, how this can shape a lot of things in Africa in terms of, I'm looking at female entrepreneurship, making things in Nigeria for Nigerians, and innovation and creativity. I know I'm lumping a lot of things into that, but how do you see what you're doing contributing or speaking to all those things?
You know, one of the ambitions I had, well, I still have it, funny enough, it hasn't changed. I don't know why I said that. But one of my ambitions is to open a school to train people into doing what it is that I do. A lot of the guys that I have on my team, they're very young. I believe in young people because I recognize myself and I know where I came from. Not having a clue what you're doing and then finding something and then having, you know, that strength to keep pushing ahead and believing in yourself. So I'd like to kind of to do that for young people. And I think for me, where I kind of see myself and my business, it's just growing in a way that I'm providing jobs. That's very, very important for me, because in Nigeria, we know that's obviously a big issue. I came from a place where there was very little jobs, and I know what, you know, how it feels. So in Nigeria, where it's God knows how many times worse for the young people, I'd like to grow that. We want to sort of establish ourselves as manufacturers. We're not interior designers. We're not trying to make pretty things. We're trying to really contribute to the change that's happening here. And I do hope that when that change starts surfacing and people are really seeing the changes properly in their daily lives and the benefits of those changes, I would like to be part of that dialogue as, you know, one of the people who contributed to that. So that's really...
So job creation.
Job creation and just building... I've always wanted to build something. Remember, I said I never knew what it was, but now I do, and I'm doing it. And I want to see that build, and I want to see how it impacts the lives of other people.
How is technology helping your business, or how would it help it better?
How would it help it better? I think, obviously, as a manufacturer, it's just relationships, isn't it? Connecting with people. And like I said, visibility for me, it's very, very important in what it is that I do. Nigerians like to buy what they see. They like pretty things. Technology allows me to give you open access to what I'm doing. And to be honest with you, that's basically what my business has been.
So do you sell online in Nigeria?
We do sell online. We're on Konga. You can find us on konga.com.ng, I believe. We also sell on Instagram, which is quite odd.
Get.
Yes.
You don't have a website?
We do have a website, majorschesterfield.com. You can go on there. But that's not e-commerce, because Nigerians do not buy
that kind of money
through a cash, I mean, a card system. They want to feel it and see it. We have a workshop in Surul area. We have a showroom also in Surul area. We're working towards getting a showroom on the island at some point as well. But yeah, that's basically what we're doing at the moment.
I'm going to end this conversation by asking a series of fire round questions, and it's just one statement question that you can answer as with another one statement or as quickly as you can. Are you ready for that?
Yes, go ahead.
Good. So, what is your biggest business pain point at the moment?
My biggest
business pain point.
Yes. I'm not entirely sure at this stage. I think for us, it's because we're very much in that experimental stage. We're experimenting with a lot, so we don't quite know just yet exactly where we are in terms of
our... So what are the challenges that you face now?
The challenges we're facing is light.
It's okay, energy. So infrastructure.
Infrastructure is a big one for us. Those are the things, I feel like that's everybody's challenge at the moment. So I don't...
What is your number one growth metric? What is the number that you look at on a weekly, on a monthly basis that indicates that your business is growing?
The number of clients that number of clients we interact with. And then obviously we work out averages and stuff from that. But for us, I always say to my team, it's a numbers game, isn't it? The more clients we come across, the more sales we're about to make.
Yes.
If I'm not seeing any clients, then I know I have a problem.
Which book are you reading at the moment?
So at the moment, reading The Image of Africa and the Trouble with Nigeria by Chinwe Achebe.
By Chinwe Achebe. It's one of his last books. So what is the thesis of the book?
I think it's talking from my experience of a student. I've just started it. Student in a university, and then how he's sort of kind of perceived by sort of his peers and things like that through the socioeconomical perspective or something along those lines. But
okay. Which business is getting you excited apart from your own business?
In Nigeria, I'll probably say agriculture. Part of Nigeria, which has nothing to do with what I do, but there's this big shift back to what our ancestors used to do. It's exciting because I'm seeing more and more young people turn into that, and it's such a weird narrative. Because like me, you expect to see an old man doing furniture, but and with there, you expect to see an old man or woman.
Similar to you working on just
yeah, and doing something different. Yes, young people are now farming. That's just so fascinating for me. That I'm really excited about what that means for Nigeria in years to come.
And it could be very interesting and more impactful as well. It's been a pleasure talking to you in this podcast. I really enjoyed listening to your story and what you've done, and I'm also looking forward to maybe visiting your showroom.
She can buy some furniture.
Yeah, but I don't have a place in Nigeria, so
we'll get you a place, don't worry.
Yeah. So yeah, it's been great talking to you. I really enjoyed it, and I hope you enjoyed it too as well.
I did. Thank you so much for having me.
Thanks for coming, Demi.